Welcome to Hindu Analysis, 4th September 2018. So today we are going to see all these articles. So the first article is the green shots of revival on BIMSTEC summit. So last week, the inaugural session of the 4th summit of BIMSTEC was taken place, and in that, India exposed its commitment with the BIMSTEC member states in the critical sectors such as the trade, economical activities and transport, digital connectivity and the people-to-people connectivity, etc. In order to realize India's neighborhood first policy as well as this Act East policy, we have to better engage with these BIMSTEC countries. So, and also engaging these kind of activities with the BIMSTEC organization is enabling us to combat the menace of terrorism as well as the drug trafficking, and it could also enhance the regional connectivity among the BIMSTEC countries. So these are the BIMSTEC countries: India, Nepal, Bhutan, Myanmar, Thailand, Bangladesh and Sri Lanka. These seven are the BIMSTEC countries. In that 4th summit of BIMSTEC, Prime Minister had also shown his interest and commitment towards the boosting of the BIMSTEC connectivities in order to ensure the speedy development of the region. And he also stated that BIMSTEC was not a substitute to SAARC, but SAARC and the BIMSTEC are complement to each other. And BIMSTEC, also the poverty plan, like the eradication of the poverty as well as the Millennium Development Goals, all these things are discussed in that BIMSTEC summit. So in that 4th summit itself, they discussed about several environmental concerns like the natural disasters such as the flood, cyclone, earthquake, which is very frequent in the Southeast Asian countries. Because if you see the location of this BIMSTEC countries, it is located between Himalayas and the Bay of Bengal, which is very prone to these kind of natural disasters. By means of information sharing as well as technological transferring between these BIMSTEC countries, and along with the cooperation among these countries, we can easily mitigate the losses which could be resulted due to these natural disasters. So if you see in terms of population, nearly 1.5 billion population, that is 22% of the global population, is contained by this BIMSTEC countries itself, and the GDP is nearly 2.7 trillion. And we all know that the BIMSTEC is a regional organization for the technological as well as the economical cooperation among the South Asian countries as well as the Southeast Asian countries. If we see what are the positive outcomes of these 4th summit of BIMSTEC, then so far the BIMSTEC followed the Bangkok Declaration of 1997 for the conduction of these kind of summits. But in this 4th summit, they decided to draft a separate charter for the BIMSTEC instead of the old Bangkok Declaration of 1997. And the second major positive outcome is a permanent working committee is supposed to be established for preparing the rules for the procedures while conducting the summit as well as between the summits. And the secretariat has also been promised with additional financial as well as the human resources for the efficient functioning of the BIMSTEC countries or BIMSTEC's plans and agendas, and to establish the BIMSTEC Development Fund for the efficient functioning of the BIMSTEC, and increase its visibility and stature in the international flora to make it glorify more, and to identify few core areas. We are having a lot of core areas, and among that we have to choose certain specific core areas like connectivity, trade and investment between these BIMSTEC countries, people to people contact, security, science and technology. So we have to make these core areas very important, and we have to take measures in order to improve these kind of core areas between the BIMSTEC countries. So these are the positive outcomes of the 4th summit. So even though the 4th summit looks so positive, but there are certain concerns in that summit. The first one is, it's been like 14 years since free trade agreement got signed between these BIMSTEC countries, and BIMSTEC is also wanted to establish a free trade zone by 2021, but there is not even a single word which is spoken about that in this 4th summit. And also Energy Center was also established in 2009, but it is still struggling for the operationalization. So it is also a major concern. So the motor vehicle agreement as well as the coastal shipping agreement is also need some more time to get the final shape. So as of now, this BIMSTEC summit is not regularly conducted, and it is happening as and when possible by the BIMSTEC countries, but it should be regularized. That means it should become an annual affair. It should be conducted regularly every year. So if it is happen, then it will create a very major positive impact in the BIMSTEC outcomes. And what is the way forward here is, the think tanks of the BIMSTEC countries, they suggested, that means walk the talk, which means it is not just the time to deliberate, but it is a time to deliver the promises which is put forward by these BIMSTEC countries during the BIMSTEC summit. As well as, if we follow whatever we promise, then only the Bay of Bengal region is heading to a positive, peaceful, prosperous as well as a sustainable future. So the next article is, the Niti Aayog constituted panel urges some plan to save the Himalayan springs. So what the news here is, the spring water system in the Himalayan state, that is the vital source of water for both drinking as well as for the irrigation to the indigenous people who are living in the Himalayan regions. So to salvage or to rescue and to revive this spring water system, efficient management plan of the spring water should be made. So that is what this article dealt with. So if you see this Indian Himalayan region, it is extended from north to northeast. We all know that. So it nearly contains 60,000 villages in the Indian Himalayan region, as well as it is home to 50 million people. So nearly 64% of the cultivable area in the north and the northeast region, that is majorly fed by these natural springs which is present in the Indian Himalayan region. So we have to make sufficient measures in order to prevent the decline of these springs which is in the Himalayan region. So this Niti Aayog constituted panel suggests that we should take some efficient measures in order to arrest this decline of the spring water systems in the Himalayan region. So what actually urges us to come to that conclusion is the recent report, which is Inventory and Revival of Springs in the Himalayas for Water Security. So in that report, what they stated is there is a threat in the Indian Himalayan region, mainly due to the urbanization as well as due to the climate change, and also the increasing demographic pressure on the existing water resources in the Indian Himalayan region is also a major threat. And because of all these factors, already 60% of low discharge springs, or the smaller springs, that is declined already, and which led to the acute water shortage for the drinking as well as for other domestic purposes. That means water scarcity is prevalent all over the Indian Himalayan region. So that is what stated in that report. So not only the springs are getting declined, but it is also getting contaminated. There is a lot of pollution in all the springs, especially due to the microbial content, sulfates and nitrates, mainly due to human activities or the anthropogenic activities, and also the contamination by means of fluoride, arsenic and iron. So which is mainly due to the geogenic activities. Geogenic means it is not because of human activities, it is because of earth triggered activities. So what is the way forward here is, the spring water management should be made, and it should be a multidisciplinary and collaborative approach, as well as preparing a digital atlas. So this is also what they suggested in that report itself, that is preparing a digital atlas of countries' spring sheds, wherever the spring sets or these kind of springs are located in the country. That digital atlas should be made so that we could track the status. So as well as the para hydrogeologist, they are also should be appointed in order for grassroots level conservation of these springs, and for the introduction of a spring health card. So we already have some soil health card which monitors the health of the soil. Similarly, we should also have some spring health card which should monitor the health of the spring. So the next article is, beyond uniformity on ruling out UCC. So recently the Law Commission, in its consultation paper on the topic of reform of family laws, what they stated is, instead of going for this UCC, which is the Uniform Civil Code, we should reform the family laws itself. That means we should promote equality within the law which is governing each community. We should not be focused only on the Uniform Civil Code to make sure the uniformity. We can also make sure this uniformity by means of reforming the existing family laws of each community. So it also advocate for the removal of the discriminatory provisions which is existing in all the religious laws, which means in terms of marriage, divorce and succession and adoption. So in all these important aspects, we should remove the discriminatory provisions whichever existing according to each community. So that is what Law Commission recently proposed. So the Law Commission has put forward some suggestions. The first one is 18 should be the marriageable age for all the communities and for all the genders. And because we already have men's marriage age is like 21, which create a stereotype that wife should be younger than men. So in order to curb that, we have to make 18 as the marriageable age. And the second one is decriminalizing the adultery, which the adultery in turn making, usually we make adultery as a common ground for divorce. So if you have to decriminalize the adultery, that is also they put forward. And division of the property should be equal between husband and wife after divorce, and removal of illnesses that can be cured or controlled. If a disease can be cured or controlled, then that disease should not be used as a ground for getting divorce. So that is also stated in that suggestion by the Law Commission. And to give equal treatment to both children as well as for the parents of any gender in guardianship as well as in the adoption matters. And last suggestion is abolition of the 30-day notice period for the civil marriages to prevent the misuse. That means the couples who are opting for the cross-community marriages should be adequately protected. In order for their protection, the 30-day notice period of the civil marriages should be curbed. So these are all the suggestions which is put forward by the Law Commission. So what is the way forward here is, if you see this Law Commission suggestion, in a strict sense, it looks like it goes against DPSP, which means DPSP mainly aims or favors this uniform civil code. But in a world which is increasingly culturally diverse, what we actually need is not the uniform civil code, but equality, non-discrimination and avoidance of taboos. These kind of universal principles is what we needed rather than the uniform civil code. So just because the Law Commission also states that just because the mere existence of the difference between these religious laws or the family laws, just because that smaller differences which is existing in these laws, it doesn't mean that there is a discrimination existing in the country, but it means it is an indicative of a robust democracy which is prevailing. So that means in spite of the differences, there is a unity in diversity. So the next article is still too many children out of school. So if we see the largest number of child laborers, they are in India. So in the world, India has the largest number of child laborers, which indicates that many of the children are getting out of school very frequently. And if you see this 2011 census, nearly 8.4 crore children are out of school in the age group of 5 to 17. And one concern here is the Ministry of Human Resource Development. They released a report in that they stated merely 60.64 lakh children are out of school. But that is a contradiction, because we nearly have 8.4 to 4.5 crore of children who are out of school every year. So the NSS report, which is the National Sample Survey report, recently stated that the 6 to 18 age group of children, in that nearly 4.5 crore children are out of school, which constitutes 16.1% of this age group. So among 100% of 6 to 18 age group of children, among that 16.1% are out of school every year. So in that, the Uttar Pradesh is the very worst performing, which means Uttar Pradesh has most number of out of school children, and followed by Odisha, Gujarat, Bihar, Madhya Pradesh, Rajasthan and West Bengal. So the in these states and all, 1/5 of the children are usually getting out of school every year. And if you see other case, Kerala, Goa, Sikkim, Himachal Pradesh and Tamil Nadu, they are better performing, which means its out of school children ratio is little bit lesser than the national average itself. So they are better performing, but these are worst performing states. These worst performing states are mostly in the northern side rather than the southern side from this weekend. So though the 10 years after the enactment of this Right to Free and Compulsory Education Act, as well as 16 years after making this right to education as a basic fundamental right, the output of the implementation of these acts are not up to the mark. So this is just a comparison where this out of school children ratio is very prevalent or very higher. So it is higher in rural India than urban India, and girls are frequently out of school than the boys, and children from especially from SC/STs was the highest who are getting out of school, then followed by the OBCs, and the Muslims was as high as 24.1% in rural and 24.7% in urban area. So as a whole, from this we can get the conclusion that the out of school children is mostly from rural areas, and among them the highest proportion is SC/STs and Muslims, and among them they are mostly economically backward. So this is what the conclusion that they come from the survey. And they also come to a conclusion that most of the out of school children belong to low income families, because 99.34% of the families of the out of school children are either landless or marginal, and the father's annual income is nearly less than 50,000 rupees. So those children, 58.19% of the out of school children belong to this kind of family, and mothers of this 88.45% are uneducated, and the parents are usually casual laborers. So these low income family children are mostly getting out of the school at an early age. So what they are stating is, if the provisions whatever putting forward by the right to free and compulsory education, if those provisions are implemented successfully, then we can easily curb those kind of out of school children scenario itself, but they are not getting properly implemented. That is what they stated. So if you see, the first two are the provisions under the RTE Act. The first one is, the school should be available at a distance of 1 kilometer for the primary level and 3 kilometer for the upper primary level. But if we see in reality, it is not getting implemented as of now, and infrastructure facilities should also be there. That means the student should have an environment friendly culture in the school, but it is not yet achieved. So what they have proposed is adequate number of schools at a prescribed distance from the children's home should be ensured first, and secure mode of subsidized travel to the schools, especially for the girl children, should be ensured, and financial support should be provided to the poor parents. This is why, because lack of awareness among the people, because people have don't even know that the right to education is a fundamental right, as well as the importance of the education. So they are not even aware of the importance. So we have to make aware the people what is the right and what are the importance of getting that right. So the next article is the impact of river linking project. We all knew about the National River Linking Project, which is India's massive civil engineering project. So if you see the intensity of this project, then it involves creation of 29 canals of length of 9,600 kilometers, and it involves a movement of nearly 245 trillion liters of water. So generally, this interlinking of river, what it aims at is turning the water or diverting the water from the surplus region to the deficit region in order to make the deficit region fertile. So this is the aim of this interlinking project. So if you see in this picture, the Krishna River and the Godavari River, it is interlinked through canal. So this is Patti-Seema project. Okay, so similar to this, every river in our country which is very deficit is interlinked with the surplus rivers. So that is what the aim of this interlinking of project. But we don't know about the another side of this interlinking of project. That means what could be the negative impacts due to this kind of interlinking of projects. That is what mentioned in this article. So in the journal Elementa, which is the Science of Anthropocene, in the journal what they actually stated is the impacts due to this interlinking of project. What are the negative impacts? First one is, if in India, we all know that the Ganga, Brahmaputra, Indus, all these are the perennial rivers, but due to this interlinking of projects, it reduces the inflow of the northern rivers. So that is the first major negative impact. And second one is, it reduces the sediments which is deposited by the rivers in deltas. So rivers are while flowing, it deposits some sediments at the coastal areas or at the delta areas. So this interlinking reduces the flow of the river, which in turn reduces the deposit of these sediments. But why it is a major concern means, on the other hand, the sea level is also increasing, but now the sediment deposition is also getting decreasing, so which led to the intrusion of the seawater into the land. This is the major impact. And also the coastal areas will also get eroded. So this interlinking of project could also threaten the land and livelihood of the local economies, which is nearly supporting 160 million people. So the rare ecosystems as well as the vital agricultural areas, these are also more vulnerable to the negative impacts of this interlinking of canals. So the interlinking of canals could lead to the coastal erosion, deposition of sediments getting reduced, and sea intrusion. So everything is making this ecosystems and agricultural areas even more vulnerable. So these are all the negative impacts which is put forward in that journal. So if you see in this picture, it is an interbasin water transfer link, which means it is this linking of project, and it has two things. One is the Himalayan component, another one is the peninsular component, and each and every red line, it is a canal which is between two rivers, which divert the surplus water to the deficit area. That is what the intention. So what are the future impacts of this interlinking means? They suggested that the Ganga will see a 24% decrease in flow. So the Ganga river is first getting affected. So even the tributaries of Ganga like Gandak and Ghagra, they also witness a decrease in the flow. Similarly, Brahmaputra will also see a 6% loss in the flow of water. And its tributaries like Manas, Sankosh and Raidak, they are also witnessing the decrease in the flow. So the third major impact is the trapping of the silt in reservoir itself reduces the sediment deposition in the coastal area or in the deltaic area by means of 30%, which means it getting reduced by 2.5 millimeter every year, but at the same time the sea level is rising 5.66 millimeter every year, which could lead to the sea intrusion and floods, etc. But one thing here is the Cauvery will see an increase in flow. These are all decrease in flow, but Cauvery will see an increase in flow. Especially the Penna tributary is having 450% increase in its flow, though the sediment discharge is similarly only maintaining. That means there is no change in the sediment deposition. So it is also a major concern. So already we lost the shoreline of Krishna, Godavari and Mahanadi rivers. So we have to take some quicker and adequate measures, and we have to make sure the precautionary steps while making or implementing this interlinking of river water projects. So the next article is the Bedaquiline boost. So this Bedaquiline is a medicine for tuberculosis. Okay, so tuberculosis is a disease which is affecting worldwide. If you see in this picture, nearly 10.44 million cases are registered under tuberculosis, and in that 1.8 million deaths are occurring. So these are the countries which is majorly getting affected by TB, okay? So recently the World Health Organization, what they suggested is the patients with multi-drug resistant TB, they, instead of administering with injectables, they should be given this oral medicine. That is what they suggested. What is that oral medicine means? This bedaquiline, this is the medicine. So what is this multi-drug resistant TB? So it is resistant to at least two of the first line drugs. If a patient is getting administered with 2 to 3 levels of drugs for their TB, but still they are not able to combat the disease, still they are, that means now the patient is becoming resistant to the drugs. So that is what this multi-drug resistant TB. So instead of giving them injectables, you should give this bedaquiline, which is an alternative drug for that injectable. Why not injectable means the treatment success rate for this is very low, which means nearly 54%. So it is one concern. But why oral medicine means? It shows major improvement in the treatment outcomes as well as it increases the quality of the life of the patients. So we have to prefer oral medicine than injectables. That is what the World Health Organization recently suggested.